I too would like to thank Alba and Paloma and everyone who has made this conference and really the food that you've been helping us eat for the last 2 days has been amazing. So my talk it's a little different than maybe what we have heard thus far, and that will be fine. So I'm going to start, instead of with nature, which is often a starting point for American art, I'm going to go a little bit different direction, and I'm starting you with in a 2015 artwork by the Jamaican-born artist Neri Ward called We the People. It's 27 feet wide, or a little over 8 meters, with multicolored shoestrings on a black background. We the People begins the preamble to the United States Constitution, a revolutionary document for its time, ratified in 1788. The US Constitution is the world's longest surviving written charter of government. The guiding ideals and aspirations outlined within it, however, excluded many, essentially guaranteeing equality and rights only to landholding white men. Much has changed since the Constitution's ratification. In fact, it has been amended 27 times as recently as the 1990s, but the document continues to affirm the US government's service to its citizens. Ward's translation of this iconic phrase into everyday materials references a shared American history in all of its beauty, messiness, sadness, and triumphs. The artwork reminds us that American democracy requires embracing our individual differences, like each of the colorful shoelaces that make up the whole, in the ways the shoelaces cause the words and letters to come in and out of focus. It can also destabilize our foundations. The shoestrings that make up the piece can be fuzzy, make it hard to see. Sometimes they even go missing because these are directly into the wall. Overenthusiastic guests can pluck one out from time to time. What an apt metaphor, truly. In its messiness and complexity, this, I will argue, inspires us for ways to present and also represent American art. We the People greets our visitors to the collection galleries at Crystal Bridges Museum of American Art and frames our experience of the collection. This reference to the past, facing the present, encourages us also to reconsider historical texts. But first, for most of you in this room, indeed, maybe even residents of the United States, you may never have been to Crystal Bridges. So I want to give you a little context for where this collection sits in the geography of the United States, as well as where we sit within the history of museology in America. So this is a couple of pictures from our campus. We were founded only 10 years ago by philanthropist Alice Walton. Our mission is to welcome all, sometimes something that is hard to do, to celebrate the American spirit in a setting that unites the power of art with the beauty of nature. So our building itself, designed by Moshe Safdie, is a series of pavilions that are around these. It's a spring-fed pond, but they are dammed so that we have that very idealistic view of water and nature. A relocated Usonian home, which you see in the middle on the bottom by Frank Lloyd Wright, also completes the campus. In addition to the collection galleries, which are always free to the public, we organize and host temporary exhibitions. In even this very brief snapshot of Crystal Bridges, I also believe it's strongly important to acknowledge our role as a museum because we are settlers and guests on that land and water. So we actively acknowledge the Osage, Caddo, and Quapaw people and the many indigenous caretakers of land and water who came before us, who live there now, and will continue in the future. Crystal Bridges is located in Bentonville, Arkansas. Some might call that the heartland of America. Those on the East Coast and the West Coast might call it flyover area. So it depends on your perspective and point of view. It is a destination, but with very convenient airports, easy to get to, if I do say so. Compared to other metropolitan areas, we are small. Our whole region is about 550,000 people, with only about 45,000 in Bentonville. That said, we have about 700,000 visitors a year. So, you know, we reach a pretty good audience. Initially, I will say critics were skeptical. Although Roberta Smith from the New York Times surmised, Crystal Bridges is poised to make a genuine cultural contribution, possibly to become a place of pilgrimage for art lovers from around the world. So I will welcome you anytime. Just let me know you're coming. Now, one of the things, though, that Roberta Smith said, well, she said many things in one of those early reviews, but one of the things she noticed was that art is not a recreational luxury or purview of the rich, but rather an essential tool for living to which everyone must have access. And this access point is something we believe in wholeheartedly. So presenting American art. A cornerstone of our collection is Asher B. Durand's Kindred Spirits. We've heard a lot about Durand. We've also heard a lot about one of the figures pictured here. The gentleman with the portfolio under his arm is Thomas Cole. This painting was painted as a memorial to Cole after he passed. He is there on a rocky outcropping in the Catskills with his friend and the poet William Cullen Bryant. So that's the other gentleman there. When we purchased this painting, I should say when Alice Walton purchased this painting in 2005, it had been deaccessioned from the New York Public Library. And it was an outcry. Now, whose fault was that for this painting leaving New York? Not Alice Walton's. That would have been the New York Public Library. Okay, so I'll just correct the evidence there. But one critic noted that this shopping spree, if you will, we amassed about 3,000 pieces of art from about 2005 to 2011, was part of an extended shopping spree that rattled nerves, aroused skepticism, and stimulated the art market. Yes, in fact, we did all of those things. Now, one of the things I would say is when Crystal Bridges first opened in 2011, we were a museum anxious to build a reputation. We were going to show the world that we were to be taken seriously as an American art museum, and this painting helped pave the way to that narrative. In some ways, I would say we denied our location in the middle of the country and presented canonical American art, painting, sculpture, works on paper, and we span from colonial era to about from about the 1700s, late 1700s, to the present. Largely, in fact, from the East Coast. We have early portraits, such as Mrs. Jacob Franks, part of a series of six, that is a colonial family from colonial New York, Jewish family, and a beautiful John Singleton Copley on the right of Mrs. Atkinson and her pet flying squirrel, an animal found, of course, only in North America. We have portraits of early leaders of the United States, two excellent examples of George Washington, one as a military leader, one as a statesman, and a remarkable life-size portrait of Alexander Hamilton on the right. We actually co-own this with the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Along with Kindred Spirits, we have a wide selection of artwork from the Hudson River School, such as this Frederick Church on the right, an artist also we've heard about this morning. And intimate still lifes, Raphael Peel, one of the many artists in what would some would consider America's first arts family, arts and sciences, I would argue. We have purchased at auction, we've purchased through private sales, we've purchased from some major collectors. This is a name that you all will recognize here at this museum. These paintings came to us from Richard Manoogian's collection, and I know some of the Thiessen collection here also came from that source. Richard Caton Woodville's masterpiece, War News from Mexico, and Martin Johnson Heed's series of The Gems of Brazil. These are four examples. We have 16. Into the late 19th century, we can still tell the story of the development of American art in both oil and watercolors. Oh, look at here for you, Carl. This is our Shinnecock painting. And with the figures in this one, as if they're little parts of the landscape as well. Into the late part of the 19th century, early 20th century, certainly I would say in our collection galleries, we still tend to rely on a chronological survey, but we do tell thematic stories as well. This one you could put into the theme of, you know, representation of women, for example. Our modern collection is bolstered by 101 works of art from the Stieglitz Collection that we co-own with Fisk University in Nashville, a historically black college. So when the photographer Alfred Stieglitz passed, he gave his collection to his wife, Georgia O'Keeffe. Georgia O'Keeffe broke that collection up into seven different institutions, Art Institute of Chicago, for example, Metropolitan Museum of Art, and Fisk University was one of those recipients of the generosity of Georgia O'Keeffe. Before 2011, there was some inquiry in availability of objects from this collection. It was legally determined that the collection had to stay together. So Crystal Bridge's contribution was much needed cash for Fisk. They have renovated their art facilities as well as expanded their mission and vision. And as a result, we get these paintings every 2 years. And so they go back and forth so that students at Fisk University can have access to them for half of their residence at school. This co-ownership model is something that we are not afraid of as a museum. In fact, we would encourage, and it may even be something that might be a future forward look at how museums use and share and collaborate with their collections. It's a lot of work, you know, to move the art back and forth, and it's also a risk to the art itself, but so far, it has gone really well. Continuing on in our narrative, we do have 30s and 40s work, and even 20s, like Edward Hopper's great Blackwell's Island, and the iconic Norman Rockwell Rosie the Riveter, which was used on the cover of Saturday Evening Post in 1943, widely circulated, but we have the painting that illustration was based on. We still have lots of great things into the late part of the 20th century, just a smattering here. And of course, I'm condensing for moments of time. I could tell you stories about all of these paintings. And when you come to visit me at Crystal Bridges, I will give you a tour and give you lots of stories. And I'm going to conclude the quick run through of our collection with Carrie James Marshall's Our Town. This is a painting that has been in our collection since the beginning. Carrie James Marshall emphasizing the black skin of the children here to really strongly show the visibility of African Americans. He was an artist that said, is an artist that says, I just haven't seen myself in museums. And so as a way of doing that, these monumentally scaled pictures are one example. I did want to just give a couple examples of things that we have added to our collection since we've opened. So Felix Gonzalez Torres' Untitled LA on the left. This is a pile of candy. What we own of this is a certificate of authenticity and instructions to put green candy in clear cellophane in a pile that is about 50 pounds. Now, Felix Gonzalez Torres was noticeably not one to give the full interpretation of what the art meant. But LA is a place that he spent a lot of time with his longtime partner, Ross Laycock, who died of complications of AIDS the same year this piece was made. and at the very end of his life, he weighed about 50 pounds. So Felix Gonzalez Torres asks the viewer to complete this object. By taking candy, the size and scale is very dynamic. It withers, and then it's replenished. So would Crystal Bridges have been able to purchase something like this in 2011? Arguably, maybe not. And even when we bought this painting, I would say what we have done is brought our visitors, especially our regular long-term visitors, along with us. If art was defined canonically, so I've just told you a canonical story of American art, you know, derivative from or based on, what is it? It's the master and the student relationship to European art from the beginning, realistic paintings, etc. For a conceptual piece to enter into our collection, there was a lively debate on social media. Some people thought we were crazy for buying a piece where we just had to keep buying candy to refill it. Why was this art? What happened was our visitors, our audience, moderated each other. The conversation didn't happen between Crystal Bridges and our guests. It happened amongst our guests. Yes, detractors. Yes, supporters. And that was an interesting thing for us to watch and see how much we can really trust our visitors to develop along with us. And then the portrait on the right is just another masterpiece that entered our collection recently by Jordan Castile, who painted while she was in residence in Harlem, the residents of Harlem, including Orlando, who owns this clothing shop. I have shown you a canonical story of American art. Again, we went through this chronologically. It is still something that is a backbone of our installation at Crystal Bridges. I will say this is something I identify with. I'm a trained American art historian. I have a PhD. I learned this, pretty much this story of American art. But what I want to do in my remaining time, which is not very long, is go back to the beginning and represent American art to you. I actually want to problematize this canonical narrative. This is where I think museums and art historians, I would argue at some level in the academy, are already doing some of these things. We need to be brave. We need to take a stand. We need to tell particular narratives and not be quite so afraid that our audiences will boo us. Maybe they'll cancel memberships. We've seen this happen. I've had very interesting conversations with founding members of Crystal Bridges who are mad when we take a socio-political perspective in our labels. And I think we're still fairly tame. So I'm gonna walk you through some of the things that we're doing at Crystal Bridges to move outside our comfort zone. And one of the things you probably can't see or didn't when I showed this before is the small Mississippian figure. This is a figure that was created and present in North America long before European contact. What if we really took a different look at the origin stories of American art? And I should say, I'll just point out quickly, because what I'm gonna do for the rest of the time is focus essentially on indigenous perspectives and what indigenous perspectives might tell us about American art. But I do wanna point out the people. So Neri Ward's We the People is one side of your introductory gallery, and the people are the other side of your introductory gallery. So intended to tell much more broad stories and perspectives. We move things around, we don't put everything that's from the early part of the 19th century, so contemporary art is alongside historic work. We're expanding our geopolitical borders, starting to collect Mexican artists. The reason we were able to do this with Alfredo Ramos Martinez, he painted it in California, so we're sort of like tiptoeing into this space rather than bumping the borders completely. So we're moving in these directions. And this is a high-definition portrait on the left of a fracking worker from South Dakota. But he, Johnny, happily hangs alongside George, George of the George Washington George, really, again, to question and be more inclusive of who is worthy of portraits, of a portrait being made and installed in a museum. And the other thing I will mention is that we have recently hired curator of Native American art, Polly Nordstrand. We also have specialists in Latin American art and Latinx art in Xuxa Rodriguez. And we have an open position for a curator of craft. So, and we also started collecting self-taught art. So just to give you other ways that we are expanding the notion or definition of American art is through the collections and different specialty expert areas. Okay, back to Neri Ward. And my intent to focus the rest of this talk on indigenous knowledge. Did you know, for example, that some of the original ideas in the US Constitution originated from the political system of the Iroquois Confederacy? The people of the Iroquois Confederacy are also known as the Six Nation, or Haudenosaunee. So these ideas that we think are so essential and, you know, based on the white founding fathers actually came from indigenous perspectives. So that's just one starting point. What if, alongside Alexander Hamilton and George Washington, we also showed portraits such as this one? We can't because the National Gallery of Canada owns, we could borrow it, but leaders such as Joseph Brandt. And I will let you all know, we actually are doing an exhibition focused around the US Constitution that will open in July. And it is being curated by our curator of Native American art. Not by me, I'm the specialist in early American art. So that kind of point of view is very much active in at least temporary exhibitions that we're doing. I also might offer a corrective to your map, Alba. It is great to have a map that shows indigenous peoples here, but I've just changed it a little bit. May as well just call it all Indian land. We currently have 574 different federally recognized tribes in the United States. Again, what if this was our backdrop for American art? But we too do not have the collections that support this, that completely flip the narrative in numbers. And so we've done little baby steps. I'm just gonna walk you through some of these baby steps, such as installing bandolier bags from the 1820s alongside Thomas Sully's life-size portrait. This happened in 2018. We had a year-long loan from the Nelson Atkins, but we don't own these objects, so we had to send them back. So these moments of presence have slowly dwindled back to portraits of sort of white men all along the walls, which is one of the challenges that we face. But these are good moments for us because this was the first time in 2018 that we engaged an indigenous advisory group. So local, regional, native people came in, said, I don't think I would do it that way, but you might try this. You know, so we talk very actively with our community. This is another example where we've placed a pair of parflesh envelopes alongside John McStanley's buffalo hunt. So John McStanley also goes out to the American West in the 1850s. Notably for this painting, he meets Blackfeet Indians. The parflesh, they're not Blackfeet, they're Lakota. But it's not meant to have this pairing to show a prop, something that Stanley would have seen, but rather to elevate art by indigenous artists alongside those of European American artists like John McStanley, and to remind us that Stanley met people, saw the art, and was inspired to paint this painting. I'd be remiss, however, to talk about Stanley without the European precedence. So how are we going to do this? How can we tell that story? It's not so clear. It's a blend. Isn't that part of the perspective and point of view? We have taken lessons learned from temporary exhibitions to inform what we do in the galleries. So this exhibition, for example, I went in like completely naively as a co-curator on Art for a New Understanding. And I thought, well, I can do this. Part of my dissertation looked at Kent Monkman, it's the image in the upper right. After all, he was appropriating Albert Bierstadt, Thomas Aikens. Boy, did I get an education. Not about Native American art, but about processes, about considerations, about voice. So one of the things that I learned is local matters. We had a co-curator who was Tlingit, but she wasn't from the indigenous tribes of the place where we were. We had to involve them. We had to make sure the checklist referred to Cherokee people, for example. Cherokee Nation is about 30 miles away in Tahlequah, Oklahoma. We had to, and we decided to hire art historians from the region who are also Native to review all of our texts, because language matters. The present tense versus the past tense, so important and so easy to slip into. I know these things, and I slip into it out of habit and years of training. Another project that we did, and I would argue is so important, is collaboration. So we did this little project with the Museum of Native American History in Bentonville, thinking we'll collaborate with a museum that collects Native American objects, place Native American objects in conversation with American objects, get some advisors, and we based it on Marie Watt and this notion of companion species. And this would take us back to those nature conversations we had this morning. What if we believed that the animals, the plants, the clouds were our relatives? Would we paint differently? Probably. Would we tell stories differently? Would we have a different mindset about the environment, about ecology? I would argue yes. So this was an experiment. The partnership wasn't exactly the collaboration we had hoped. It was a little messy, and me and my co-curator, who was from Cherokee Nation, citizen of Cherokee Nation, Ashley Holland, we ended up developing the checklist and then just running it by the advisors rather than working together. So, you know, experiment sometimes doesn't work. Sometimes you learn something. But I did particularly like how it made us think about and look at American art differently. Instead of thinking about Dorothea Tanning as if this is a surrealist artist, another sort of European art historical term, what if we thought about Tanning thinking about animals and humans and blurring the lines between them as if they are reciprocal relatives, and this is about storytelling. So seeing it differently. Another strategy that we will be taking soon in the galleries, and we did with a temporary exhibition, is invite someone else to curate. Give away your authorship. So Deonnie Whitehawk did that in this exhibition in honor of our 10th anniversary. It was like a little mini exhibition within an exhibition. And she put together a group of artworks from our collection. We gave her access to our catalog. She even selected, you can see it maybe there in the background, the Kerry James Marshall painting from the galleries. You know, our preparators were like, oh, no. This painting hangs on the wall with little rivets. It's not just one big painting that you take off the wall. It's fairly labor-intensive. But we had to say yes. If we have invited her to come in with her voice, we have to give over authority to Deonnie. And so we did do that. Now, by way of concluding, I want to just focus on an idea or a notion of reckoning. And what about if you can't add much to your collection? What do you do if you don't have the collections that fully support giving priority to Indigenous objects, Indigenous voices, Native American points of view? Another strategy that we take is reckoning with history and representing American art in that way. So part of this, I think, is truth-telling. If I'm presenting George Forrest Brush's Indian and the Lily, I could talk about Brush, I could talk about his European training, I could talk about the ways that he was trained to look at human anatomy, or I could tell you that George DeForest Brush painted this Apache man after he went to Fort Marion, where Native people were imprisoned, moved from Oklahoma to a prison camp, essentially, in Florida. Apache person and a Floridian landscape, they shouldn't go together. They're only together because this person was forced to go to Fort Marion. Is this what what George DeForest Brush saw? No. The conditions weren't such that you would be robust and strong, just merely tipping down to grab a lily. No, this is completely imagined. But he put those two, the landscape and the person, together based on that in-person experience, and talked about, and really the rhetoric of the time, was that vanishing Indian notation. We've heard about that a little bit this morning. And this tenuous grip that the man has on those vines, as if it could just snap at any given moment, or perhaps the bird, jury's out, different people think it's a spoonbill, others think it's a swan. The bird trade was so robust in the late 19th century that many were endangered and going extinct. So that connection with nature could tell us a very different story. So you can tell those stories in galleries. Or you can think about contemporary work that helps you reckon with history, such as Titus Kaphar's Cost of Removal. It's a powerful example of looking back at history. What Kaphar is doing is repainting Andrew Jackson, so a portrait based on Andrew Jackson's mounted, the full-length portrait. But the cost of removal, so what Titus Kaphar has done is tacked into Andrew Jackson some of the texts that he was writing when considering removing Native tribes from the Southeast into Indian Territory, what is presently Oklahoma, a blatantly racist law enacted in 1830 in the United States. And the costs were not emotional or ethical toil. They were literally dollars. What it would cost the government to develop roads, to be able to take the military in and enforce that removal of five tribes. Reckoning with history. Reckoning with history makes us also reckon with our policies, procedures, practices as a museum. Okay, so this full transparency. This is how our collection has developed over time and the makeup of it. So I can stand up here and tell you, we need to have artists from many different backgrounds, male, female, non-binary artists. What do we really have in the Crystal Bridges collection? Primarily that of white men, especially in the early parts of the collection. So doing these statistical analyses is meant to hold us accountable, to make us as a curatorial team change our practices. So you can see the demographics over the past 10 years. You can see it slightly changing. And you know, when you have, thankfully we only have a little over 3,000 objects, we can change it at a greater percentage. For a museum that has tens of thousands of objects, it's gonna change a little slower. But I suppose my takeaway would be, I can make a difference. And when this is presented for me, that is a bit of accountability. This is also what they were prepared for the board. So our board of trustees knows that this is the makeup of our collection and knows the directions that we aim to go. We are embracing the power of craft, self-taught artists, Native American art, to expand our definition of American art, challenge fine art hierarchies, and connect with the diversity of American art practices, past, present, and future. I've just shared with you our collections plan. It doesn't have more than that. I wish it had more than that. We're working on more than that. But that's the benchmark for which we hold ourselves accountable, to build a distinctive American art collection that represents artistic excellence and quality, promotes inclusion, belonging, and relevance for broad audiences. That's it. I will also say we've used this dashboard to work through what we would need to do to make our collection a little more balanced. Now, projections show that if we acquire 50 new artists, not 50 new artworks, 50 new artists, distinct artists that are not already in our collection, each year, and half are ethnically or racially diverse, we will still only have 35% of our collection non-white in 20 years. It's daunting, but we'll try. We're not gonna get there, but we gotta, if we just give up, we're really not gonna get there. And so we're gonna keep trying. This is a recent acquisition for us. This was a little stretch. We don't collect, by definition, so-called decorative arts. But we acquired this major David Drake vessel. David Drake was enslaved in Edgefield, South Carolina, and his story, well, it's remarkable. You can see how large it is and how much presence it has in our galleries. So that's my very professional iPhone photo of the current installation. So it catches you from the moment you walk into this space. And that was really important to us. This isn't about like checking a box and saying, great, now we have a David Drake jar. This was about making sure it was excellent, an excellent example. And he was a master at what he did. He inscribed on the edge of this jar a little poem. A very large jar which has four handles, packet full of fresh meats, then light candles. It's self-referential to the function of the jar, which was food preservation, with a layer of wax, the candles, on the top to then preserve the food inside. But an object like this also points to the many other enslaved artists whose names remain unknown to us today, that we can start to tell those stories through this object. There is so much more I could say about acquisitions and the importance of museums being brave, taking a stand. But I also want to just give you a quick snapshot into a project that I'm working on now. And this relates also back to what we can see hanging on the walls upstairs. These are both Bodmer prints from our collection, but you have some great Bodmer prints upstairs in your collection here. And even in the essay in the book, it points to Prince Maximilian's journal and Karl Bodmer's prints about the American West, you know, inspiring a host of European filmmakers, author, including German writer Karl May. So Karl May wrote adventure novels about the American West, fictional Apache chief Winnetou, and his partner Old Shatterhand. So in turn, Karl May's novels are credited as Hans Henrik Thiessen Bornemisza's inspiration for getting into American art. The book also mentions that old myths have been dismantled by recent historians. I would agree, the myths of the American West are being dismantled, but they're not being replaced by anything quite so compelling. So they're gonna stick around unless we actually give an example of what we might look to, if not this. So, I argue that a European myth and a European-American created myth of the American West continues to loom large in popular imagination, overshadowing and still informing attitudes toward Native peoples today. Such as, they're not around, not true. Such as, everyone wears feather-headed, you know, feather bonnets, not true. These kind of oversimplifications. So, I'm working on an exhibition that seeks to complicate this, complicating the European-American artistic legacy of the American West and presenting Native American art as essential to cultural and artistic history of and about the West. And by extension, my hope is that this gives just a different way of looking at American art writ large, but my specialty, my special area of study, is the American West. So we'll start with what I know best. So the approach for this exhibition is to see European American art and Native American art and art made by Black Americans in the West and women and artists from other places besides Europe. So in essence, we're simplifying this, Native American art and art made by non-Native American artists together. Two-thirds of the exhibition will be Native American art. We're taking the approach to look at resilience with the Native American art, continuation of tradition amongst drastically changing circumstances in the late 19th century. Artworks that show survivance, an active way of resisting, an active way of insisting that creativity continues, such as this fabulous object by Nellie Tuberis Gates. It's a beaded valise. And on one side, you can see an image of a couple of cowboys wrangling some cows. On the other side, kind of a genre scene, if you will, of everyday life. And in some ways, you might say, oh, you could almost simplify this into cowboys and Indians. What if I told you the story was, as the Dakota people went to and were moved to reservations, this is a reflection of life on Standing Rock Reservation. Native peoples took on cattle ranching because they needed to augment the very poor food rations they were given by the US government. So this is everyday life on both sides, a continuation of a tradition of beadworking that was quillworking before then, and the top and sides of it have some of those long-held patterns. Oh, there are just fabulous examples of taking this blend of European purchased objects, such as that fabulous beaded shoes on the far right, or even grappling with what does iconography like the American flag do when you incorporate that within traditional beadwork. So the gauntlets on the far left or this bandolier bag in the middle. And some might say, oh, beads, okay, that's recognizably native. Actually, that's Italian. So the trade, the internationalism of native people from very, very, very early contact days was about adaptation, about change, about resilience, about continued traditions. And this exhibition will do that. And also reckon with the power of something like Albert Bierschaet's Sierra Nevada Morning. This is actually at Crystal Burgess right now. It's from the Gilcrease Museum's collection. The Gilcrease Museum, good for us, is undergoing some renovations. So we're just taking care of a few of their works at the moment. This is a large operatic landscape. What if we talk about not this unpeopled landscape, but some of the people who in and near the Sierra Nevadas were creating artworks like this by Elizabeth Hickox. Both are related to their place, but both are also made for the market. So Bierschaet's making this painting to sell it. Elizabeth Hickox making this basket to be sold at a gallery in New York. Fascinating. So these pairings, this rethinking and representing the context of America, of Europe, arguably, I think you can do it. I think you gotta put American art back in your galleries after this exhibition closes and not be afraid to insert it in maybe like seemingly odd places. Why not slow down the visitors? Give them something to ponder. Give them something to think about that's unexpected. So I would call for all of us to just be more brave. And take up the mantle of telling and retelling new stories. So thank you.